you suffer from chronic CFED or can't focus energy drain? Try over-the-counter Vibrin. One tablet contains the same caffeine as a cup of coffee, but without the calories or coffee breath. Vibrin. Caffeine, not coffee. Taking Vibrin may result in increased productivity and decreased dread in setting alarms. Unexpected enjoyment of the graveyard shift has been associated with Vibrin. Vibrin may be a better budget option than drinking coffee. It may also decrease the urge to doze off, skip work, or exhibit signs of slacking. All jokes aside, always read the label, take only as directed, and limit caffeine as it may cause real side effects. Not for children under age 12.
Blog Talk Radio.
If I'm acclaimed somewhere, I'm acclaimed Oakland. When I got to Oakland, that's when I learned the game. And I just saw it, and I saw it in Oakland. I saw it living in Oakland. I saw it thriving in Oakland. I just saw everybody being about the game. First time I saw all niggas thinking about one thing, the game. And they all followed one rule, the game.
Look, there's rules to the game, the way that I was raised. Donuts at the sideshow, niggas getting paid. Money over pussy, yeah, paper over age. So I'm true to this Oakland shit until the fans rage. I'ma earn it like I learn it, spin it like I get it, and give big bullets to any nigga trying to fuck with me. Be true to this game, and this game will be true to you. That's real shit. Disrespect, see what this do to you. I try to tell niggas, if you can't bail, nigga, just sit still. These quick to tell niggas, won't last 30 minutes in a quick and sell. Nigga, try to fuck with Young Rich, and I'ma ring bells, nigga. Church bells, dough bells, it's over and out. They fucking off changes what them bullets about. It's a four-letter word, but it's deeper than shit. And in this game, tell me who's deeper than rich.
If I'm acclaimed somewhere, I'm acclaimed Oakland. When I got to Oakland, that's when I learned the game. And I just saw it, and I saw it in Oakland. I saw it living in Oakland. I saw it thriving in Oakland. I just saw everybody being about the game. First time I saw all niggas thinking about one thing, the game. And they all followed one through the game.
Game recognized game, a hustle is a trade. Choppers for the bullshit, niggas getting sprayed. Bitches on some slimy shit, niggas getting paid. I'm trying to tell you motherfuckers, the boy Rich is really made. You got to be about it, to do it like I did it. And I give big props to any nigga trying to fuck with it. That jacking and robbing, despising your homie ain't healthy. Niggas being up there for get wealthy. I tried to tell niggas, niggas fail niggas. That's why I fuck with bitches and teach them to trail niggas. In town, out of town, get mail niggas. Hit them from the blind side and call them real niggas. One lick, two lick, nigga, she out. Say he fucking off change, blew his brains, no doubt. It's a four-letter word, and it's deeper than shit. And in the game, tell me who's deeper than rich.
If I'm acclaimed somewhere, I'm acclaimed Oakland. When I got to Oakland, that's when I learned the game. And I just saw it, and I saw it in Oakland. I saw it living in Oakland. I saw it thriving in Oakland. I just saw everybody being about the game. First time I saw all niggas thinking about one thing, the game. And they all followed one rule, the game.
Money is the metal, and Jesus walks, so I ain't running from you devils. Oakland is the dirt, nigga, I am the shovel. That means I dig my city on a level. Hustle, young nigga, put the pedal to the metal. Only sleep comes a dreamers, my nigga, so why settle? There ain't no turns giving, nigga, be twisting and taking shit. Putting they sack down, then putting they mac down. In a hustle-bound city, it's bound to get shitty. That's why I had to fuck with the drum that holds 50. But yeah, I'm a loner, but I got some niggas with me with them 100-round bags that'll clack them till they empty. One clip, two clip, nigga, we out. I ain't had to do a thing when them niggas jump out. It's a four-letter word and it's deeper than shit. And in the game, tell me who's deeper than rich.
If I'm acclaimed somewhere, I'm acclaimed Oakland. When I got to Oakland, that's when I learned the game. And I just saw it, and I saw it in Oakland. I saw it living in Oakland. I saw it thriving in Oakland. I just saw everybody being about the game. First time I saw all niggas thinking about one thing, the game. And they all followed one rule, the game. The rules of the game.
Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. Hitler was a killer. Frank Ward was the man. Felix Mitchell made money in 20 G stacks. Moses split the sea. King Tut wore gold. And Jesus, he's the king. So the story is told. But my posse, we keep jocking the freaks. 24 a day and 7 a week. The old town is always popping. Fill tops, gold tones. The boys ain't stopping. Not long ago. And brother, listen to me. The kid on the block was a Tari. He was the most. And he had all friends. They're playing game after game, again and again. But the times have changed and now comes the grind. The mixed up kids have to make up their mind. The slow lane, or do they want to move fast? The dope man, they say he ain't gonna last. The preacher, he's busy trying to save souls. The devil, he wants all control. You see, life is to be lived on the right accord. So don't sweat it, young brother, when you can't afford a benzo, a mobile phone, and a yacht. Because the brothers in the fast lane haven't forgot. There's a heaven and hell. You only get one turn to live eternally or to eternally burn. You're not a cat with nine. You live once, not twice. So what I'm saying is take this advice and don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. Life has flipped so many pages. The styles have changed over ages and ages. If it don't get better, then I suppose the winds of life should blow the book to close. You see, the world is corrupt and God don't like it. And one day, like lightning, he'll strike it. AIDS is taking over, and so is the COVID. But the preacher's real busy just trying to provoke the people to give at least one Sunday. Perhaps it can make life better for Monday. And if Tuesday through Saturday you stay on your knees, you notice a change. The week was a breeze. Other rappers had a chance. They blew it, so all I'm trying to say is, don't do it, don't do it. You know what I'm saying? Don't do it, don't do it. They blew it. Don't do it, don't do it. Make the move, homeboy. Don't do it, they blew it. Suckers getting jobs, they can't hold them. I'm a fiend for mics, that's why I control them. And dancing ain't never been my best thing. But I'm a fiend for music, so I entertain. And rap is not the only thing that I don't do. You get me on the court, and I'll run you in hoops. But now off the court, back to my sport. Do it. Rapping the record that you just bought. Put the tape in your deck, turn your zap to fold. Do it. Rattle and roll and bake, you know. California is the place where the hustlers dwell. But there's a message at hand that I'm trying to sell. You've got an Uzi in your trunk, a nine in your coat. Switch blade back fade, case you're cutting the throat. See, the life of flash holds cash, but now it's dirty. Those who participate, they die early. The coroner's office is way jump packed due to submachine guns and handheld gas. Dope is for pigeons, and pigeons don't burn. So in essence, repeat the final words and don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. You know what I'm saying, homeboy? Don't do it. Don't do it. Let them know.
It's your boy King Eric the Great. You're not tuned in at Off the Cuff Radio. The guillotine is in the full effect. Miss Chinchilla's in the building.
What it do, what it do? How you feeling tonight?
I'm Gucci, man, and I got my man T-Max in the building.
Where he at? Where he at?
I gotta bring him back. Sometime we go through phone issues with that situation there, but call back T-Mac. But anyways, we welcome y'all on this wonderful Friday night at Off the Cuff Radio, where you find your no holds bar commentary, your good gut busting laughs, and dope music. And we have a legend in the building right now, and he goes by the name of Richie Rich. We gonna put him on now. You on, brother?
With yes, the round sir. Of what's happening, man? What's good?
Now, before we get this thing started, we got to put some respect on it, man. We got to give you a round of ovation.
Yeah, put some respect on my
name. Name of
it. Put some respect on my name. What's going on with it?
That's good.
Man, I ain't making
What's
no
good
noise,
with your brother?
Man, I ain't making no noise. Trying to get myself together. I got a flight. I'm going to run out here to Miami and watch these Raiders play. I ain't doing nothing. What's good on your end?
You know, we had to get the team together. We had pretty much just dropped our mixtape on last Monday. So we keeping the buzz heavy. And we bringing legends like you aboard to show that love.
What's up? That's what's up, man.
I just want to say welcome and thank you for coming and spending your time with us. I know you could have been anywhere else and you down with us tonight. Appreciate you.
Yes, ma'am. You know it's good.
And he's the other guest. You're probably the second guest that said ma'am and didn't say dude. I love you already.
You know what? My mama didn't play none of that shit. You know what I mean? I was raised by a real savage. My mama, she didn't play no game, so I try to keep it respectful. You know what I mean? I could be a beast, I could be an animal, but I'm, you know, I was raised right, so I know when and where to do it at. You dig?
I feel you. But you know, sometimes I be sounding like a man, so I can't even plan to say nothing. I just be sounding like a man. Tonight I'm on my woman talk, so I guess I sound like a woman. So yeah, no, I don't be tripping.
No, you just kind of raspy, you know? But see, I'm raspy, so I can tell a man's raspy from a woman's raspy. You dig?
Huh. Real nigga shit. Feel you.
I think we got my man T-Max back on the show now. Hopefully we can get him on. You there, bro?
I'm here. What's going on? To the Guillotine Crew, to Richie Rich, to the Legend, what's going on?
T-Max, what's up with you, man? I ain't making no noise, man. Over here on the West Coast, man, just holding it down, you know what I'm talking about?
Definitely, man. Good to have you on the show with us. Definitely, and we got to give a shout-out to our King Eric, who also started off the show playing one of your older tracks that a lot of people outside the Bay in L.A. may not know about, called Don't Do It, you know, which was the precursor.
Yeah, I heard that.
Yeah. Yeah, which was actually awesome.
Heard that. You know what's crazy about that Don't Do It record? That was the first record I ever put out. And I feel like to this day, people who fool with me heavy be like, that's like their favorite record of all time, like the Don't Do It joint. You know what I mean? And I done made a lot of records, but the subject matter in that record is kind of dope. I was listening to it while y'all was playing, while I was sitting over here waiting to get on air. I was like, damn, that record still sound good. You know what I mean?
Well, it sounds fresh.
It does. Definitely listen to that album. And also, you know, in terms of, because a lot of people may not know about this. Now, while Warren G was the first West Coast rapper to be signed to Def Jam, you were the first Bay Area rapper to be signed to Def Jam.
Yeah.
And also, you were a heavy, 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 Snoop Dogg says it himself, because you started off with the group 415, which inspired Snoop. Because Snoop gives you such praise and adoration as being one of his influences, that he, with the late, great Nate Dogg and Warren G, came up with their 213 that was a direct inspiration from the 415. How does it feel to know that you inspired, you know, that your inspiration was just, you know, it just inspires so much?
Man, it's a good feeling. It's funny you say that. You know, Snoop is a good friend of mine. Snoop, Warren G, shout out Snoop, G-Dub, rest in peace, Nate Dogg. All three of them cats. You know, a lot of the L.A. rappers have always kind of told me that, you know, they used to listen to our music. But now when Snoop told me, he was like, 415 inspired 213, it was like, wow, you know what I mean? because I mean, Snoop is a heavy hitter, but he's a good friend of mine, man. I got him on this new album I put together, so we always kind of lock in, you know, and we keep it 100. Warren G is my dude too. Me and Warren, real tight. But yeah, that was for me. That was big. You know what I mean? Because you look at like when we put that 415 record out, it was a locally released record. You know what I mean?
Right.
And we didn't have no major distribution or nothing like that, so I didn't know the record was even in L.A. Our distributors at the time was just cats who were from Oakland, who went to college in L.A., went to college in Atlanta, went to college in different states, and took the tapes with them. You know, so that was our promotion. That's the way the record moved around, by just, you know, it was just word of mouth and people taking the record with them, so... That was definitely, you know, surprising to me to know that them cats was even listening to my music. You know what I mean?
Definite.
See, Mac, you really took those words out of my mouth when you said that, and I just want to add to it and kind of question one more thing, because with you making such an impact, Snoop even went as far as to say that he got some style, you know, he started kind of putting his style towards what you were doing at first. So when you make an impact like that, up to date this far, who influenced you in doing all of this and your style and what you do from the beginning till now? Who have been your influences?
It's crazy because, you know, I listened to a lot of rappers when I was coming up. You know what I mean? And it wasn't a lot of West Coast rap. So if you think about it, if you got Snoop saying he was influenced by me, and most people would think Snoop is like the godfather of West Coast rap, so it wasn't a lot before me, you know what I mean? Like, of course, Too Short was one of my influences. Short is a good friend of mine. He was one of the West Coast rappers that was popping. But a lot of the cats that inspired me to rap were cats from the East Coast. You know what I mean? I used to listen to a lot of old school rap. EPMD, Eric B and Rakim, Cool Moe Dee, LL. You know, that was a lot of the early hip-hop that we was getting on the West Coast before the West Coast actually had the ball. So a lot of the people that I was inspired by happened to be people like that. EPMD was one of my favorite groups. You know what I mean? Like I say, Eric B and Rakim, you know, cats like that that had smooth styles. Like Eric, Rakim always had a smooth style. He'd be talking a lot of gangster, but he was real smooth with it. You know what I mean?
Definitely.
So that's kind of where I got my, those were my inspirations to actually start rapping, was actually cats from the East Coast.
Word.
That's what's up. Now, I think we have our other co-host, Mr. Sandman, in the building, man. The man that got so many lethal balls, it'll make Tyrese cry. What's good?
Now that right there, hey, you's a cold gangster for that, because I just got up on that. I saw some people talking about it, but I hadn't seen the post. And then I saw the post, I was like, oh, wow.
1, 2, 1, 2.
Hey, that Instagram heavy.
He's here. He's here, man, in the building.
What's going on, y'all? How
bars
y'all feeling, man?
Tyrese bust tears, man. You got to calm it down in the studio.
Man, we're going to get to that motherfucker later on, B. Right now, we're going to talk to the homie Rich. How you feeling, Rich?
Man, I'm hanging like wallpaper, sticking like glue, my dude. What it do?
And that's camping right there.
Hey.
You know what I'm talking about?
I already can dig it, man. Nice. I'm glad that you're able to join us this Friday night on Off the Cuff Radio.
Oh, man, the pleasure is all mine, man. I'm glad y'all got me on here. You did?
And I wanted to say one thing. Like, when I just had called in, I overheard you saying that the East Coast influenced you when it came to hip hop. That's definitely what's up. You know, a lot of rappers from the West won't admit to that, and you're like, you one of the first to admit to that. Especially when you drop EPMD and stuff.
Well, one thing about Rich, it ain't no fluff on mine. I don't never fluff nothing. I mean, I'm gonna keep it 100. Anytime somebody asks me something, You're gonna get it raw, and that's just what it is. Like, to be honest with you, like, EPMD to me, still, like, I met Eric in Paris once I got to Def Jam. But, like, them cats were some of the coldest to ever do it. And I even went further back than that because my older brother used to listen to a lot of rap. And my brother was 10 years older than me. So I was getting doses of, like, Spoonie G. You know what I'm talking about? And it was a lot of old school rap that cats probably don't even know exists. You know what I mean? Like the boy Jimmy Spicer, Count Kulout, all that shit was shit that my brother and them was knocking. And all that kind of stuff. That's just what made me want to put rhymes together. And that was before hip-hop was even, you know, really cracking it on the West Coast. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it was, so it was popular, like, most likely in the South Bronx, like around my area. That's where you used to have the, like the Fever. They used to have, like, the block parties.
Right. Oh, yeah, man, I know the words to almost every Sugar Hill joint. I mean all that. That's all my, because my brother used to DJ back in the day, so he had all them records, and that's how I got introduced to, you know, Curtis Blow. Let me not leave him out. Curtis Blow was one of the coldest cats to do it too, like with the breaks and all them records.
Hell yeah.
Fat Boys was one of my favorites. The Fat Boys was one of my favorites too. I got some remake records I made of the Fat Boys. So like groups like EPMD and the Fat Boys, that's kind of what inspired me to do the 415 thing and want to be in a group. You know, but them dudes had big records. Like, Can You Feel It was a big record. Don't You Dog Me. You know what I mean? The Fat Boys, to me, like, was super dope. You know what I mean? So I go way back. I don't want to really keep going, you know, to have a listen and be like, okay, that nigga old. He mentioned in that old school, but that's what it is. Like, those are the cats who made me want to get out. You know what I mean?
Definitely. We're on Off the Cuff Radio. Call-in number is 1-619-924-0703. We're on live and direct with one of the Bay Area legends, Richie Rich. Now, Rich, in terms of you being from the Bay Area, there is what I call the Big Four and Big Five, because you definitely played a part in it as well. But please, tell us from Too Short to Hammer to the late, great Mac Dre to E-40, you know, and yourself, because you came, you know, in between all of that, between Mac Dre and E-40. But tell us about the Bay Area scene as it began to develop and was a burgeoning player on the hip-hop landscape, from where L.A. started in 86 with Ice T, you know, with Ryan Pace, who was one of the bigger, was one of the albums to come out. But Too Short, of course, started in the Bay. But how did the Bay really start to manifest itself?
Well, the first rap that I knew of in the Bay Area was Too Short, period. Like, he was the one that was making tapes, selling tapes. He was the most popular. That was before any of the Mac Dre's or the E-40s and all that. 40 and them had been around. I knew 40 and Be Legit just from the streets back then, because they all had cutlasses, and I got a cutlass, so we used to ride cutlasses together. I knew them cats from just like the, from the game, you know, just in the street, because around the Bay Area, is, you know, we called it the dope game. A lot of people was hustling, you know what I mean? So Short was the first cat who was actually putting records out. He started from making tapes and selling them out the trunk, then he signed to a company called 75 Girls.
75 Girls, yeah.
And then Jive picked him up, and he started actually making, like, albums, you know what I mean? And then from there, it's cats that didn't make it to the big label game. Like, it's a cat named Dangerous Dame who used to be out, who was making some noise around the town, too. And then they had, a cat named Father Dom, you know, Paris. Paris was more like an X-Clan type of dude. That's another old school group I used to listen to a lot, the X-Clan.
Sleeping,
you know,
with the Enemy, of course, Paris the Black Panther, Devil Made Me Do It.
Grand Verbalizer, what time is it? You know what I mean? I used to be off that Grand Verbalizer, you know what I mean? So from there, we had a cat named Paris from the Bay, and then that's when the rap kind of started evolving. I didn't get active until 89. 89 was the first year that I actually put some music on the actual sidewalk, where people could go buy it. By that time, E-40 and the Click had been doing their thing. Mac Dre had been doing his thing out of Vallejo. So everybody had been kind of cooking, but like in their own region, in their own zone. You know what I mean? And like Vallejo is 45 to 50 miles away from Oakland. And you had Rapid Fortes coming out of San Francisco. You know what I mean? You had a bunch of different little nooks and crannies of the Bay Area where everybody kind of was cooking, trying to get their little rap moving. So I would say from there, we put a record out in 89. That's when we first started getting some light. Short was already moving. He was on a major label by then. He was on Jive. And then from there, Digital Underground slipped onto the scene. They had their little thing they was doing. You know, then Three Times Crazy with Keek, Adrian Man, and Bart. Keek the Sneak then popped up out of nowhere. Drew Down slid into the game. The Loonies slid in after Drew Down. And we just kept popping up. And then we start getting some recognition from, like, record companies. Like, okay, the Bay is making some noise. And that's when the record companies start coming in. But Short spearheaded the movement for the Bay.
Definite. Because, I mean, also,
right
across, yes. I mean, and also he had the Who Riders as well. You know what I'm talking about?
Oh, yeah.
About,
yep, the Who Riders.
Big,
yep.
Yeah,
MJ,
you know, Mr. Chuck
San Quinn and them came out of the city.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, Chop Black. Young Mess. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. And a lot of, you know, everybody in all the little areas just kind of start cracking off, you know, and it was just more and more rap coming from everywhere. Now, I don't know. I can't say for sure how long all those guys are. I can't give you a pinpoint deadline of when all them cats came on the scene. But I know it started with Short on that major scale. And then 40 got the Jive. I think 40 got the Jive prior to me getting the Def Jam. But as far as the major cats, the cats that landed big label deals, it was Short, 40, myself. I don't think Drew Down ever signed a major deal. I know the Loonies did a major deal. They signed with New Tribe Virgin when they came with the Five on it record. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Jobs go out to Drew Down.
Which
were
you on the remix
of?
You want to read it?
Shouts go out to Drew Down. He was on the show not too long ago. Like, I think he was on the show this past summer, I think it was. Was it this past summer or this past
Yeah,
shouts go out to Drew Down. We were chopping it up with him.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Real funny cat right there.
Oh, my God. Yeah, Drew's a good dude. Good dude.
But now, going into your transition to going on Def Jam, because usually, it's usually said that the Bay Area has set the independent blueprint down flat pretty much. So what made you want to take that vision to the next level and go to what was an East Coast label as Def Jam?
Well, you know what? By that time, a name that I didn't mention, Tupac, had slipped in the game. He slipped in through the Digital Underground channel, and he was signed before I was signed. He was signed over at Interscope. And when the Def Jam play came in, I was still, like you say, I was getting independent money. You know what I mean? And I was doing all right. Tupac was one of the first cats who told me that I should sign to a major company. He was like, man, you need to get on a major label. And then back then, getting signed was like the thing. You know what I mean? That was just the goal. Everybody was just trying to get signed. You know what I mean? And I'll be honest with you, like right now, the music has kind of gone back to an independent thing because with the help of the internet. But we was getting it independent when the record companies had everything on lock. Record companies have kind of lost their footing a little bit with the introduction of the internet and the YouTube and all that.
I know you grew up in that era where you definitely had to beat your feet. You had to be on that pavement walking around and, you know, signing up to open mics or whatever has the mic open. I know even sometimes you probably had to you had to put motherfuckers on the on a stronghold, a stranglehold, and all that, because you know how certain DJs would be. They'd be like, oh nah, this particular rapper said you can't rap on this mic. You know this, so you're gonna be what? I'm better than this motherfucker.
Oh yeah, it was plenty of parties where I would be at trying to get on the mic just to freestyle, just to do my thing, and you know, now they call it hating, but you know, back then we used to call it motherfuckers throwing salt, you know what I mean? They're throwing salt, not trying to let a guy get on. But I mean,
we still call it that, throwing salt. Niggas are still iron chefs out here.
Yeah, you feel me? The streets gonna always speak up. as far as like who's who and who making a little noise. I was really kicking up more dust in the hustle game, and that's what got me, you know, the visibility in the rap game, because people knew me from the street. People knew me for the cars I was driving, you know what I mean, the work I was selling. So I was a reputable name in the street before I was with the rap shit. And then once I got my craft together and I started busting, like I told you in 89 when we dropped that 415 record, that's kind of what solidified me in the Bay Area rap game. It's like, okay, this nigga, he be spitting, you know, he got bars or whatnot, you know, and that's what it used to be about, you know. It used to have to
and
be
so that's how you
get to even get on, you know what I mean?
And that's how you got the name Richie
you
Rich.
You didn't have
you
no
basically
game
got
on
the
that
name
microphone.
Richie Rich from... That's what I'm saying. You got that's where you basically
what?
Got the name. That's where you basically got the name Richie Rich from. We got it from you being in the street.
Yeah, I got,
instead of you being in
I
the
got
microphone.
The Richie Rich name from. Yeah, I got the Richie Rich name from being on the street. You know what I mean? From just my hustle ethic and the kind of cars I was whipping around in. And you know, I was like 17 when I had my first Rolex. You know what I mean? Because like the dope game was heavy where I was from, and we had a whole lot of heavy hitters. Like we was wearing presidential Rolexes, like in the street in 84 and 85. It was cats with Rolex. So you know, that was my blueprint, came from the hustle game. In my era, like Oakland was one of the prime get money cities. We had crack first. Crack started in Oakland. We had it before anybody had it. It was in Oakland in 81. You feel me? It went from...
Oh, wow.
So we had it first. Yeah, it was in Oakland in 81. You know? And then, it didn't start getting rocked up to like 82, 83. But like, I remember cats
yep.
when I was in high school. Coming
and that's
to school
when I was born,
bad.
82.
Yeah, 82, 83. That's the golden era. 85 was like...
Hey, you know I
got to
ask you.
Coming out year.
You know, I got to ask you real quick. You got to answer this real quick. Because if you answer this question real quick, I know you're not lying. Answer this real quick. You ready?
Yep, I'm ready. Always ready.
The best car you ever drove?
Best car I ever drove? Shit, I drove a lot of best cars, buddy. Shit, my 5.0 was the first best car I ever drove. But shit, I don't roll them all. I done had a little bit of everything. Bentleys, I done had Benzes, Range Rovers, but I mean, my 72 Cutlass is still my favorite. It's in my garage right now.
There you,
you know
go,
I mean?
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. I know you was gonna talk about that
yeah.
old school pimp player shit. You know what I'm saying? 72 Cutlass.
Yeah,
that's
72
that OG
Cutlass.
Shit right there.
Yeah,
it's
in
my
garage
right
Supreme.
Now, you know what I mean?
Oh, they're doing on them youngest. They ain't gonna know what to do.
Yeah.
And it's
seven
and it's
convertible,
crazy.
Man.
And it's crazy, Rich, because you mentioned a convertible, which is also made famous by E-40, of course, is, you know, the Booger Green with the gold Daytons, the gold folks, rather. But also, if I can indulge our listeners as well, you know, coming up in the street hustle game like you was, you also probably crossed paths in terms of knowing an individual by the name of Felix Mitchell out that way in Oakland, you know, the Young Don.
Oh yeah, Big C was having all the money. C was so big, C wasn't even driving. C was getting to that bag. We was babies in the game. And see, the cold thing about it, when C and them had the game, we didn't really know what was going on. Because, see, they had the game, but they had it in silence. And y'all could probably relate. It's kind of like y'all parents. Our parents did shit that we never knew nothing about. Because they did everything in silence and secrecy. See, as the game start getting to the younger generation, young people are the ones start just telling everything, you know what I mean, and doing, letting everybody see everything they do. But yeah, he started it out our way. You know, he had 69.
I'm glad you said
up.
That. I'm glad you said that. Like, it's not that much secrecy, basically, you know, because everybody want to push you online.
No, now.
Everybody
want. Your 3-year-old kid know how to cook dope now because he done seen his daddy do it. And his daddy partner do it, and you know it just ain't no secrecy in the game, no more. You know,
because they can be posting that shit on social media for likes.
Be on the ground.
Yeah, and also
they be on the ground with how to cook dope recipes, step by step. Categorizing the game.
And I'm
look. But
I'm gonna cut into this and then I'm gonna cut out of it real quick. I got this little thing that I tell people when they ask me about the game and what happened to the game. Because I got young people, they be like, how the game get fucked up? The game, I mean, y'all talk about how y'all used to get it. What happened, man? I mean, what messed it up? I'm going to tell you exactly what happened. When I was in the game, it was a pecking order. And the pecking order went a little something like this. The man who was copping kilos, he was selling to the dude who was buying half a key. The man who was buying half a key, he was selling to the dude who was buying 9 ounces of better. The dude who was buying 9 ounces of better, he was serving the dude who was buying 4.5 ounces. The dude who was buying 4.5 ounces, he was serving single ounces and halves. The dude who was buying the singles and halves was serving quarters and eight balls. And the dude who was buying quarters and eight balls was serving 16ths. And the dude who was buying 16ths was serving rock. That was me. I was buying 16ths for $140. And I was serving rock. That's how I got started. So somewhere along the
that's
line,
that's how you do it. You always got to start from the bottom
the
and build
man,
up.
Yeah. The kilo man started being down to serve the rock man. And you know what that did? That cut out all them jobs, cut out all them positions. And that's when the game got shitty. You know what I mean? When niggas got greedy.
Yeah.
Especially when niggas start learning.
I don't care how much.
When niggas start learning how to cook themselves. You know what I'm saying? When niggas started learning how to cook themselves, they come out, a lot of those middlemen got cut out.
And also, too,
I don't care how much. When I came up, I don't care how much money a dope fiend had. When I came up, I don't care how much money a dope fiend had. A dope fiend could have $17,000, $18,000. He couldn't go buy a kilo with it. He could get him $17,000 or $18,000 worth of rock. That's all he was eligible to get because he was a dope fiend.
Hell yeah, because you know they're gonna need that. They'll do anything for that motherfucking beam up. They're gonna do anything. Like you can even have some real good shit and put a ridiculous price on it. Like trust and believe, I've been through the bullshit too. And them niggas will do anything to get that shit. And they will tell you that's how motherfuckers used to be killing them back then, B.
And it's crazy
used to be killing them.
And it's crazy you say that, Rich, because also, too, but it also, and Illa, because y'all both, you know, break it down, but also, too, this is also around the time in the late 90s, you know, late 80s, early 90s, when Charles Cosby was beginning to come up, you know, with Griselda, because he was getting his product directly from her, you know, so he was moving his own merchandise, you know, in terms of, he was his own organization, you know.
Griselda
you know,
Blanca.
If y'all, look, for our listeners out there, if you have not seen Cocaine Cowboys 2, which was about Griselda, which was really about Griselda and Charles, you need to watch that. That is a hell of a history lesson,
or
you
just
know,
Google
about how it went down.
Just Google that bitch, Griselda Blanco.
The Black La Madrina, the Black Widow, the Godmother.
Game for you.
Definite.
Yeah, there was a lot of hustling going on in that Bay Area.
And definitely, now, you know, Chinchilla, you know, King, Ella, myself, we have always, one thing, and we know about your home, Rich, in terms of Oakland is outstanding on the high octane of the hustle. Don't nobody got the muscle to move like the town do. From the independents, because we also forgot to talk about some of the other guys that came up in terms of the music as well, and I wanted to segue that in terms of the then to now, because we got to give a shout out, of course, to Mac Mall, Kyrie, you know, Ray Love, YBB, Young Black Brothers.
Yeah, I don't know how I forgot Mac Mall. Mac Mall, he came in that same Mac Dre era, and Mall is a real one. Mall is one of my guys too, always been a spitter. You know what I mean? So
definitely
want to give Maul his props. Definitely want to give Maul his props because I fuck with young Maul. He a real dude.
And definitely
can't forget
like
about
I
40
so
Water.
Many, I probably.
Oh yeah, we mentioned
I
40 Water earlier.
Definitely can. Ooh.
Earl, man. You know Earl. Like I said, I knew Earl and them from before the music game. You know what I mean? Earl and Vila. See, it was a lot of cats who did it in the streets. And it was a lot of cats who did it through the music. You know what I mean? But most of us, we evolved from the street to the music. You know what I mean? And that's kind of what solidified our music, was what we were doing in the street. You know, a lot of people, you could put out music like now. You can listen to music and you hear some of the stuff. You'd be like, okay, that boy can't really be doing that he's talking about, because if he was, he wouldn't be able to talk about it. You know what I mean?
Definitely.
Better not be doing it. So. he say better not be doing it.
Hell yeah, but they still be doing it. These dumbass these days be doing it and be going on wax and telling you about it, and then wonder why the wrong pop. Not only them, they partners, the niggas that wasn't even known in the streets. And later, come on, dummy.
Oh yeah,
because they retired.
Yeah, knock them all down. That's what happened to the boy Bobby Smurda and them, huh?
Man,
I was thinking about. And then when these niggas not even a part of this shit, that's going down, but they hear it secondhand, and then they go tell on every goddamn body and get thrown in the mix. Nigga, you ain't gangsta, you just slip, bitch. What's going on?
Man,
this is shit that kills me the most. I didn't mean to cut you off, my guy, but this is shit that kills me the most. When the rapper stitches on himself on that particular record, and then when he gets locked up or arrested or whatever, he'll sit there and say, oh, yo, niggas is out here snitching on me. Niggas out here hating on me.
You snitching yourself, you fucking mongoloid?
Hey.
Like, what the fuck?
You want to hear something that's crazy, though? You want to hear something that's crazy? Coming from a real nigga who really got some money in the street, what I don't like that rappers do, and it's a lot of our favorite rappers, niggas who was nice with their craft, you know what I mean? I don't like when niggas get on wax and tell on the gang. Niggas talking about, oh yeah, I put it in my girl between her legs and she got on the train with it. And like, I mean, like, what is you, niggas, you drive snitches. It's still niggas who still in the street, niggas, who got to use their vices to get money. Like, just because you made it out, my nigga, like, I don't understand that. Like, I don't understand the rappers.
You know what it is, Rich? You know what the thing
is,
my guy?
Them is the niggas that I be believing that ain't never really got no money in the street.
No, I just think after a while, you know what I think? I just think after a while, people just run out of shit to talk about. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Like,
you gotta think of it like that too. You know what?
You know what I'm saying? They sitting there talking about, okay, they selling drugs and all that. It's but so much things you could talk about when it comes to selling drugs. You know, after a while, you're gonna use up everything. You're gonna keep going to the well too many times until the well doesn't have any more water in it.
But to give up the whole game and like he said, you drive niggas and all niggas and stop doing it. Not even
It happens. You know what happens? Because one rapper is going to want to top the next rapper, and that rapper is going to want to top that rapper, and then so on and so forth.
And you know
it's
what
called
else?
Evolution.
You know what else it come from? And you know what else it come from, too? Like you said, trying to top the other one. It turns into each nigga wants to tell the realest street nigga story.
Niggas get so engulfed
in trying to be the realest nigga that they don't realize, like, you fucking it up for the niggas that's still in the hood that don't rap. The niggas who might need to steal Twitter on the train.
Hold on, Rich. I didn't mean to cut you off. Hold on, Rich. Chilla.
I think there's some noise in the background.
That's Chilla. She over there barbecuing or something.
That's my name. It's mad loud over there.
What you doing?
Always keep going. Hey, I like this interview with radio station. It's ghetto as a motherfucker. It sounds like it's a dice game going on in the back. Somebody's baby daddy back there getting checked. It's a lot of them going on.
And you got the dope music playing in the background.
Rich. It's live radio. You never know who could call in. You never know what may happen. It's live radio or off the cuff radio.
Definitely not Rich.
Nah, but seriously though, Chilla, what's up, Chilla? You
that's not Chilla, nigga. I'm trying to tell you, I ain't got shit. I done ran from a team. I done ran from everybody in the house. I secluded myself. That ain't me, my nigga. Not this time.
So who is that? Who? That's you, T-Man?
No, I was just, well, I heard the commotion. I was going to say, yeah, Rich, now in terms of you've told us about the glory years.
I was just doing T-Man all the damn time. My bad, Chill. I thought that was you.
He tried to be
low-key
about it.
She's like, motherfucker, that's not me. Get it together.
He gonna listen one day, goddamn. Hey, before y'all get off of this topic though, because he made a good point. I understand what y'all talking about, niggas trying to top other niggas. But let me tell you something. That is how the game is changing as well. When the deep code is no longer, you be quiet and you move in silence. When everybody want to top everybody on wax in the movies and all of that, they wonder why. All of these fans is running up in places. Them alphabet boys got more work to do. It's because these niggas don't give a fuck about nobody else. They care about their money. There's money and this fame and this reputation is getting in the way of the game. The G-Code has changed. He is fucking it up. These rappers fucking it up. These movie producers fucking it up. I understand this shit be golden because it's on the movie. Nigga, damn, you ain't got to be that real, my nigga, damn. Because you know what? When them niggas stop selling CDs, and they got to go back to the streets, they're the fuck they sell. I'm just saying.
I want a rich. And that you hit the nail right on the head, Chilla. You hit the nail. I just wanted Rich to repeat what he said. You know, this dude T-Mac walking through parades and all of that.
Right. What part do you want me to repeat?
When you was talking about, remember when I was you was reiterating what I said. Well, basically, when one rapper talk about one thing, the other rapper is gonna try to, you know, out rap that.
So basically, what it turns into, every rapper wanna be the realest nigga, you know. And you know what else killed me? When niggas get on and start saying, yeah, I ain't no rap nigga, huh? Well, get off the mic,
I'm a hustler.
I don't like that either. When niggas be like, yeah, I'm a street nigga, I ain't no rap nigga. Well, you show over here in the way, man, because that's just like you can't go get on the NBA floor, and you know, be like, oh yeah, I ain't no hoop nigga. I'm just out here fucking with it, you know, because I got a ball and some sneakers, nigga. If you ain't no rap nigga, get out the way. The sport is rap. That's what this sport is. So if you're a street nigga, it's plenty corners. And it's a whole lot of dope still left to be sold. Get your jive ass over there and get back on that shit. You know what I mean?
Definitely.
But it turns into every nigga wants to be the realest nigga ever. So then, like you say, they lose sight of what you're doing. Nigga, you snitching. You telling. Man, you're going to talk about the compartment that you got in the bin. Yeah, you're going to talk about the compartment that niggas got in the bin. And you nigga, you telling. Okay? I know you might not think you telling, but nigga, you telling. And if people listen, okay, and the people that's listening, now you get a nigga 20 to 30 years who was minding his business. He was your fan. He was buying your music, nigga. He was supporting what you're doing, nigga. So won't you support what he's doing and shut the fuck up? And if you're out of material, then nigga, you just out of material. Nigga, go sit your ass in the fan zone and shut the fuck up. But
there you go.
The key niggas, like the major niggas, some of the nicest niggas to ever do this. I done heard these niggas do that. They just kill
them.
Say
Richie Rich, tell them how it is.
I was born in the dope game, my nigga. And like I tell people all the time, it ain't fair because just like Killa just said, you may have to resort back to that. You never know. It might get ugly. You know, a nigga might have to resort back to that. So leave that jewel. You know, buried underground, man. Don't dig that up and just set that up here for everybody to see it just because you hella thirsty for whatever reason it is. Nigga, if you a rapper and you trying to rap, I tell niggas all the time, it's two kind of rappers. A nigga with a story and a nigga telling stories. The rawest nigga is a nigga with a story. You feel me?
Yeah. You know what I think also? I wanna build on that like Legos. When it comes to rapping, even if you are a hustler, there's so much shit to rap about. You don't have to sit there and try to be like you the biggest drug dealer in the universe. Hustlers go through more than drug dealers.
That's what niggas. Well, see, that I'm gonna tell you something, my nigga, and I'm gonna keep it 100 with you. Them is the niggas who didn't get the validation in the street. Because when you got validated in the street, you would never have that problem. Because niggas already know that you was that nigga. So you would have no.
So you don't even have to keep mentioning exactly. Yeah, to constantly do that.
All that big time dope dealing on record. Them niggas wasn't big time dope dealing on the street. I ain't saying they didn't sell no dope, but they wasn't big time dope dealing. Because if you was ever big time dope dealing, you know somebody or you close to somebody who done been in a little bit of trouble, and you know how serious it is. I done been in trouble on all levels, state and federal. You know what I mean? So I know how serious it is and how these people can sweep the rug from up under a nigga's foot. So my whole play was, when I was selling coke, I was rapping about selling weed. And when I was selling weed, I was rapping about selling coke. You know what I mean? So I'm always trying to... trying to throw a little diversion in the game, but I
that's some real shit he's saying. That's some real shit he's saying right here.
I was just trying to coach niggas. Like anytime I talk about the game, I'm trying to let niggas know the pitfalls of what can happen out here in this shit. You know what I mean? I never really glorified the game. You know what I mean? But I let niggas know, like, it's money out there to be got. And it's a way to get to that bag. But it's a flip side of that too, my nigga. So, because I know it's kids listening. It's kids listening.
I think the number one rule to that, I didn't mean to cut you off. I think the number one rule to that shit, first and foremost, is that don't be out here doing shit illegal if you don't have to. That's what I say. If you was born with a silver spoon in your mouth, or you was a middle class, what may have you, don't be out there doing unnecessary illegal shit just to be cool or popular, whatever the case may be. Because them same motherfuckers you showing off for, your ass end up in that can. You don't got no commissary or nothing.
You gonna get a swirly.
No, I'm saying you done. Like, you thinking you get...
Ian Illa always said, when the alphabet boys come and start throwing them football numbers, your ass singing any motherfucking way. So shut the fuck up from the jump and stay in your lane, goddamn.
Fucking judge, the judge tell you fucking mandatory 15? You looking at niggas like, man, look, fuck you.
Oh, yeah.
They start telling on Tito wasn't even in trouble. Laws didn't even know Tito's name, and they start telling on, I got a nigga.
A motherfucker telling you, the judge is telling you 10 to 15 mandatory. You don't even have to do the time. Just you telling me that, I learned my lesson. I don't want to do nothing else ever again. Like, I don't have to go to jail. Like, your honor, I learned my lesson. I'm going to be a Christian. Fuck that. 10 to 15
years? What you going to do like Nino Brown? You going to tell him this is bigger than Nino Brown. This is big business.
Now, definitely, now, Rich.
Nigga, Nino Brown snitched on everybody. Nino Brown said, man, if I go down, everybody go down with me. Fuck that. I'm not the one that started this shit. This is big business.
Educated brother from the bank.
And definitely,
Miss Hawkins.
And definitely, Rich, I wanted to ask you, too, because also, because we have definitely had the, this has just been a symposium on all thing hustle and how to not tell and why you shouldn't tell and when niggas do tell and they get themselves fucked up because they told. But I kind of also want to take this in a little bit of a more serious direction. As successful as the Bay has been, we have also seen some very serious beefs that have escalated into violence. You know, God bless Keep the Sneak. He's alive after his shooting. And that was, you know, and then we also have had the issues that have happened with Kafani and Filthy Rich that also resulted in Kafani's shooting. Not saying, of course, Filthy did not do that, but still, you know, from the beasts that have been going on. What is the climate that has been going on in the Bay Area right now when the situation has popped off with a lot of rappers? Where are the origins of a lot of those beefs coming from? Is it really stemming from music, or are there outside situations in the street that have unfortunately bled into the business as well?
Well, I don't have the particulars on, like, the Keith Sneak incident. My experience with beef between rappers and the beef, the shit that happens in the Bay Area, is the Bay Area ain't no different than where all y'all at. Right now, everywhere is active. And everybody is active. You know what I mean?
Right.
See, when I came up, everybody wasn't active. Just like I said, it was a pecking order. Everybody couldn't hustle. You know what I mean? If you knew who the killers was, you could count them on one hand. It was two or three niggas that you knew was killers. Like, now everybody is a killer. You know what I mean? So, right now, if you ain't paying close attention and trying to stay alive, you can fuck around and get dead around this motherfucker. And that's just, and I'm pretty sure it's like that everywhere. You know what I mean? So, like, the beef with Kafani came from him not taking a serious situation serious. He figured he was going to go. He figured he was going to go over into an area of East Oakland that has been
Seminary, which was 50's home block, 54th Seminary.
That has been well known as a kill zone. Okay? Like, and for whatever reason, he figured he was going to go over there and he was going to attack one of the rappers from over there, and he was going to disrespect him by shooting a video in his hood. Now, the funny thing about that is, that neighborhood, even if the rapper who was from over there wasn't there, them boys is active over there. You ain't going to disrespect a spot like that. So basically, Kafani ain't no street nigga. You know what I mean? Because if he was, anybody from Oakland knows Seminary is not no place to be over there fucking around on no level. You know what I mean? Them boys, they not for play over there. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that's how that happened. That was one of them situations where you got so caught up in rap that you forgot rap and street ain't always the same thing. You feel me? And
it cost him his mobility.
It cost him his ability to walk. You know what I mean?
Definitely.
You know, and it's a sad thing because Kafani is a good dude. You know what I mean? And so it's filthy. I know both of them guys. They both good dudes. But the thing is, like, we got a saying that we say around here, gang recognize gang. And you got to recognize, like, there's a difference between this rap shit and this street shit. See? Say I'm from over here, and you from over there, and me and you beefing, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And one of my homeboys feel like he gonna come over into your neighborhood and project to the world how soft y'all is, and y'all like, well, shit, that ain't got nothing to do with rap, nigga. You disrespecting my neighborhood now, nigga.
For real.
And so we gonna get active. And like I said, that area where he went into is a known active neighborhood where they don't be playing at. So, as far as the Keith incident, I don't know the particulars of what happened with Keith. I know he was out late at night, and like I said, right now in any ghetto in America, you know, anything can happen at any time. So you gotta be trying to stay alive around this motherfucker. You know what I mean?
Really?
Yeah, definitely. I didn't mean to intervene for a second, but I remember looking at an interview that you did a while back, and it shows also that you are actually one of the few stand-up guys in this rap game, because you was actually one of the few people that actually told Tupac about the whole Death Row affiliation. You wasn't really feeling it.
Mm. Yeah, well, you know, he wrote me when he was in jail, and he was told me that Death Row was interested in signing him, and asked me what I thought about it. And at the time, I just told him, I was like, Snoop Dogg was popping at the time. Death Row was huge, but Pac had already released the Me Against the World album, and it did well. And I just told him, I was like, I don't think you need Death Row. You know what I mean? I said, you kind of got your own thing going. I don't think you really need that. And then I sent you this. Now, we ain't on the phone. We talking between letters. So I licked the envelope and sent it to him. And then when he wrote me back, he was like, well, this nigga is talking about coming to get me. And my Interscope ain't talking about coming to get me. Now, me being a nigga who done been in a sticky situation before, I couldn't do nothing but respect that. I mean, shit, you're talking about getting you out of jail. And I know, I mean, any nigga that done been in jail, I mean, you ain't got to be a punk to want to come home. Shit, nigga, you want to get the fuck out.
That's prison.
You know, you ain't, that don't make you no punk because you want to come home. Shit, nigga want to get out. And he told me that Suge was talking about coming to get him, and Interscope wasn't. And I told him, I said, well, shit, my nigga, you... All I can say is, nigga, you got a valid point. You got a valid point. You know?
I would say one thing about that, you know, minus, you know, Pac dying or getting murdered, as, you know, correctively saying, while he was still on death row. Other than that, I think death row was actually what made Pac more popular, you know, because before then...
Well, you know what, dude, what it did do for him is it gave him the ability to move mean. All right, because Suge had all that power at the time. Pac had all that celebrity, and Suge wanted what Pac had, and Pac wanted what Suge had. I was inside that with both of them cats. I was watching it from the bench, being a nigga with gang, so I could see the whole thing. Pac wanted to move hella mean, and Suge had the power for that movement. So, you know, when you got the wind under your wings. And you own the music. Just, I mean, your momentum just gets better. You can look at the Golden State Warriors. They done won one. You know what I mean? Then they go get the boy Kevin Durant. Now they just moving mean. It took a long time for me to even believe that the Warriors was good. I've been with these niggas forever, and they ain't never been this good. So it's kind of one of them things when any popular rapper you can look at, once he gets the win at his back, you know, a nigga just start moving mean. Pac was always good.
It's all about momentum.
He just wasn't talking.
You're right. It was really all about momentum because
he was able to talk about more shit once he got to death row because he was seeing more shit. Pac is a revolutionary. Pac was a black man. He was about positivity prior to death row because that's the shit he was seeing. His family was Panthers. That's the shit he was seeing. But when he got to L.A., I don't know if y'all have never been to L.A., L.A. will give you every bit of what you want and then some. He starts seeing shit. And that's the best thing for a nigga with lyrics is a window to look out of because now you got unlimited material. The more shit, more fly shit you do, more fly shit you see, the more fly your song's going to be. Period.
The more shit you got, the more shit you can talk about. That's
doing.
Always good. Like,
yeah,
the more things you see,
about. The
more homework that you have. The more things you could talk about when it comes, you're so right.
Yeah, the double album worked too. You know he had a lot of stuff on his mind.
Yeah.
And definitely
he
also
seeing and doing a whole lot more. So the music got a lot better. You know what I mean?
And definitely Rich, because you were on Me Against the World on Heavy in the Game, and that was in '95. But then also too, you appeared again on '96. You know. On Ain't Too Hard to Find. I mean, how did you see, you know, from that year and two albums working with Pac and among so many, because, I mean, we still got so much, but from that particular time frame, how did you see that transition and that evolution of Pac's style from 95 to 96 between Me Against the World and All Eyes on Me on those two songs? What was the evolution of the execution of rhyme on it for him?
Well, you know what was different? Like, I met Pac in the 90s. He came to Oakland, and I met him. And we was on gangster shit. We was doing the 415 shit, and he was doing the Black Power shit. And we was homies. We met up. We started smoking together. We started kicking it. And naturally, niggas like, man, I want to do some music with you. But what I was doing and what he was doing, I was like, nigga, you on that Black Power shit. You don't want to do none of this gangster shit. You know what I mean?
I said, used to be cooling with Tretch also. Because
yeah,
I know that, like, Pac and Tretch was real close. Like, they was like brothers.
Yeah, I fucked with Tretch. Tretch came to the West Coast a few times, and I done pointed Tretch in a few of the right directions, man, with a few ladies over here and over there. You know, me and Tretch, we done fucked with it. Tretch is a good dude.
Hey, quiet as hell. Is he married right now? Because, hey, if he's married right now.
Like Bernie Mac say, long time ago.
Because, you know, people do. You'd be surprised who's listening to the show, you know, so.
No, but I'm just saying, I mean, I fuck with Tretch heavy, and I know him and Pac. They had a real relationship, you know what I mean? And Tretch, you know, you've been seeing him on the gram. He's been going to bat for that boy. And I don't know what's going on with some of the little backlash he's been catching from that, but it is what it is. He got love for the nigga, and he's going to ride for him. That's what it is. Me and Pac's relationship.
Fortunately, that situation with him and Watt, they
yeah, you know, we have to bring that up. That's a whole segue.
Yeah.
Me and Pac's relationship, I ride for the nigga. He's my guy. But you know, I don't let what people say about my nigga get me unhinged. Cause I know who my nigga is. I know who he was and who he wasn't. People can say what they want to say. Everybody's gonna have an opinion. But I don't let that shit get me unhinged. You know, and then at the end of the day, it's like, my man been dead a long time. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
My man been dead a long time. You know, so I don't know why all of a sudden it was just such a big hoopla about the boy. But you know, cats will say what they want to say, and some cats got valid points. You know, like.
And I'm glad you took the grown bars answer basically, because at the end of the day, the other people is looking crazy, talking crazy about, you know, Pac's name. First of all, he can't even defend himself. He's been gone for so long, and people are still talking crazy about him. And, you know, there's people like Tretch, that'll still ride. And it's like, why? I don't understand that. Why you think they still talk ill of Pac? Like, I just don't understand that. Like, let the man just rest. It's getting to the point now where they talk more about Pac than Biggie.
Right. Well, the thing is, like I said, Pac had a life in a lot of places. Like, Pac knew niggas from New York. He fucked with niggas from Bay Area. He fucked with niggas from L.A. So it may be some valid points that people from L.A. may have seen with Pac that I didn't see. It's some shit that I know about Pac that's around here that niggas from New York may not know. So if he was a well-traveled nigga, so he's been around. He's been a lot of places. You know what I mean? So... But at the end of the day, to me, the nigga goes down in history as being one of the nicest niggas to ever touch a microphone. I don't give a fuck. And a nigga can say, well, he wasn't no killer, or he wasn't tough. Man, it goes right back to what I was saying. We're talking about the sport of rap. This is not boxing. This is not the army. Nigga, we talking about rap. The sport of rap. Niggas run up on me, talk about me, how you feel about Biggie. Biggie was nice as fuck. I fuck with Big. And Pop used to have an issue with that once him and Big fell out. Like, I mean, you be listening to that nigga's music. I mean, nigga, I'm a fan of niggas who get out, niggas who nice. And I tell Pop to his face, I'm like, that nigga Biggie nice. Y'all niggas need to iron that out, whatever it is. Cause the nigga Biggie nice. You can't take that from him. I don't give a fuck. You know, Pac did his thing. Niggas always ask me, well, who you think is the best, Pac or Big? To me, if you want my honest answer, Pac just had more material. Big didn't have as much material, so I can't really judge it.
Yeah.
That's real shit.
Because when Biggie was partying.
Like a boxer who didn't have five. Yeah. It's like a boxer who, if he had 500 fights, versus a boxer who had 25 fights, but the boxer who had 25, he's 25-0. He ain't lost none, but he still only fought 25 times.
Like, you know? Basically, when Biggie was out partying, Pac was always in the studio. Like, Pac had his fair share of partying here and there, but Pac was always focused.
Man,
like, I heard
this.
Plenty of stories
about
matter of fact, it's been plenty of stories that's been told here. on Off the Cuff Radio.
Let me tell you something about Tupac, my nigga.
Motherfucker talking about this dude will actually be in the studio all week ordering pizza and writing rhymes.
This nigga would not leave the studio, nigga. I was witness to that. I was a nigga who wanted to get to the club. Let's go fuck with some females. Let's get out. Let's move around. He like, let's bring some females up here. I'm like, well, shit, let's go get some food. Let's bring some food up here. We'll get the food delivered. And he's like, well, shit, let's go get some weed. We have some weed brought up here. Like, the nigga's work ethic was relentless. That's why the nigga had so much motherfucking music. But that
Pac,
goes back
Pac
to...
Pac would have loved Uber.
That
Pac would have probably been sad by now.
Well,
Pac would have loved... Pac, he would have loved Uber Eats. He never leave the studio, and he got Uber Eats? Pac would have been... He would have been the little Biggie. Big Pac.
That goes back to his upbringing. Like, Pac grew up without. So he had a hunger that was different than your normal nigga. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
He just had a hunger that... Hold on one second, fellas. Hold on.
Gotcha. Yeah, man. But that's some game, man. He did, you know, Richie been telling us. Off the Cuff Radio, calling number 1-619-924-0703.
Pac had a work ethic that was out of this world, my nigga. And that dates back to his original, who he was as a rapper. The nigga was a revolutionary. Yeah, he got to L.A. Then his mind got clouded with gang banging and money and jewelry. But that ain't who he really was. See, that ain't who he really was. Who he really was the Dear Mama dude. He had a lot of that other stuff in him, and he's a chameleon. He could adapt to whatever. But his work ethic showed, man, the boy put up numbers as far as the people ask me about Tupac, and they'd be like, if it was anything you could say, I'd be like, I just hate that he put in all that work and didn't get to enjoy none of his riches, because he was in and out so motherfucking quick. He was in and out
and
so quick. You feel
and
me?
It's crazy, Rich. And it's crazy, Rich, because I want to ask, because there's also another fact, too, that a lot of people don't know, that he was the first artist to have a number one album while he was incarcerated. And I also wanted to ask you this, Rich, as well, because a lot of people feel that the Death Row situation in Los Angeles was not the best for him. A lot of people feel like he would still be alive today if he was still in the Bay because he had that ample protection. How do you feel about that?
Run that by me one more time. I was talking to you and to somebody else. I want to make sure I answer the question right. What'd you say?
Okay, yeah. I was saying in terms of about the facts for our listeners who may not know, Tupac also was the first artist to have a number one album while he was incarcerated. And also, as well, a lot of people feel because of the Death Row situation, because of the volatile nature, especially from the 95 Source Awards with Suge, that people felt like that was really ground zero for the East Coast, West Coast beef. And a lot of people feel that if he was still in the Bay Area, because he was so beloved there, and he worked with, you know, E-40, so many people, that he would have been protected in the Bay Area, and he might still be alive today. How do you feel about that?
Well, I'm a believer in God, and my whole thing was I was always upset that I couldn't keep up with the boy because the boy got a lot bigger than me. And when I used to be with him, his mom used to always say, like, he's a different dude when you're around. You know, he'd be grounded when I was around him because he was little bro. So he'd be grounded when I was around him. It'd be times when he'd get cocky on a nigga, but he'd be more grounded whenever I was around him. So I've said that in interviews before, like, I wish I could have been around. I think the nigga probably would have still been alive if I could have caught up to him. But at the end of the day, me being a God-fearing dude, you know, things just go the way they're supposed to go. You know what I mean? And I was just always taught to believe that, hey, if this is God's plan, that's how it was going to rock. And we can't see around corners, you know what I mean? So it would be nice to say, hey, if he was around here, he'd still be around, blah, blah, blah. But, I mean... You can't see around corners, you know what I mean? So you can't really say that and it hold no real weight because that may not be a true statement, you dig?
Definitely.
Yeah. And going into the historical context of, and going into the historical context.
I do wish he had more of niggas who really loved him though, who could have really held him down out there with him when he was moving around. I can't say that.
Right.
Because when you're moving around with paid security and you're moving around with new love and niggas that's with you because of what you do and not niggas that love you for who you are and not what you are, you know what I mean? Shit can get clouded. You know what I mean? Because I got homies right now to this day that'll let me know, nigga, you moving sideways, nigga. Tighten up. You know what I mean? Period. We don't give a fuck, nigga. You just came across the Grammy stage and blah, blah, blah. But still, nigga, you moving sideways. Tighten up. Them the kind of niggas I like to keep around me. You know what I mean?
Right.
Because it's easy to get clouded out here. Not just in the music industry, but shit, you could just be moving through the streets and have it kick your way. And, you know, if everything go your way for so long, you kind of start feeling like, oh, shit, I'm God out here, nigga. I've been winning, you know? And it's always cool to have somebody who can pull your coattail and tell you, nigga, you ain't God, nigga. You need to tighten up. You're moving wrong. You know? And when you have
real
a little
talk.
Bit of that, sometimes that's going to keep you lined up. You know what I mean?
Definitely.
That's real talk, bro. And going into your up-and-coming album coming out, and you gave us the first single to promote titled Oakland, and it features vocals from Pac. How's been the reception been for that song so far?
Man, they loving that Oakland record, man. That Oakland record is getting some real good reception. And it was just a warmer. It was really like a leak record that I leaked. I didn't even put a lot of promotion on it. I just shot a video on it and just dropped it just kind of, you know, as a warmer. I dropped it on Tupac's birthday. And, I dropped it on his birthday. And I just kind of wanted to, you know, get some feedback from the people. They've been loving that record. That Oakland record is coming off of a new album I got called The Fed Case. Okay, so I got two records out there off of that. I got Oakland and I got Whole 30. And I'm about to release the last single that I released off that record before I let the whole record out. And it's called Where I'm From. It features Filthy Rich. So the Fed Case album is coming, what is this? This is November. It's coming this month. I believe the date is November 24th, I think. I'm not sure. Don't quote me on that, but it's coming this month. And then after that, I got a follow-up record for that, another album that I'm dropping on 420 called The Grow Room. And The Grow Room is it's a collage of weed songs. It's 14 weed songs, all produced by the mechanic, and it's got features of all stoners, all niggas who's known to be stoners, you know what I mean? Red Man, Method Man, Snoop Dogg, Burner.
Oh man,
Khalifa. It's a collage of it's just a bunch of nice smoking records, shit that you can just get high to and vibe to. And it's called The Grow Room. And The Grow Room is gonna drop on 420. So basically, I've been working, man. I've been trying to get back greasy, you know, because the game for a minute I had kicked back and I was just kind of listening to what was out there. And, I mean, I ain't trying to knock the new music because I guess that's probably how people felt when we first came out. They was like, well, this don't sound like what we used to. But I am convinced that it's still some room for this shit that Rich do. So I'm going to continue to do it. You did?
Dude, you said the mechanics. Shout out to Kenny Tweed and 4Racks. If you, ladies and gentlemen,
yeah,
if
boy,
you're not familiar.
Them niggas got me sounding good, boy. Them,
man.
Them niggas got me sounding good, boy. Them niggas.
For our listeners out there,
shout out,
if you are not familiar, if you are not familiar with the mechanics, if you are not familiar with their music, because they've been doing it since 1999, and they are what you would call the mob art, the architects of the mob audio out in Oakland. Their sounds are unbelievable. If you want a perfect example, in addition to Richie's upcoming album, listen to Mozzie's Hit and Run that they did the beat for. It is unbelievable. Rich, you said those two. Plus you,
yeah.
It equals dope all around. Oh, my God. Yes,
man.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, that grow room is hot. It's produced by the mechanic. Hey, check this out, fellas. I just got a text from the Grand Wizard, and I don't mean the one from the Ku Klux Klan. I gotta get to this airport, man. I'm gonna have to tap back in with y'all because it's been live. Like y'all got a live setup. I could go all night with you niggas. You feel me?
We thank you.
For real. We
gonna
set that part two up.
Yeah. We gonna set that part two up so we can get all the way greasy, because I do want the listeners to know. I mean, it's a lot of people that don't really know the full schematics of me and what I represent and what it is I bring to the table as far as just this music game and street game. So we gonna lock in on that part two. I'm gonna go jump on the jet. I'm fixing to get out here to Miami. Get out here to Miami and fuck with Short. Short got a show in Miami this weekend. The Raiders is playing out there, so we gonna run out there and fuck with that Raiders game and go do this little Short show. And
town,
man,
yeah,
town business. Yeah, that's
yeah, that'll be awesome. Hey, we gotta check that up. Like that'll be pretty awesome if we have Too Short on the show. You know what I'm saying? Like we fuck around we got Too Short on like Valentine's Day, one of them shows. Teach these motherfuckers about some game.
Yeah, let's go. I'll let
the
him
Godfather.
Know. So yeah, y'all try to y'all set it up with Sean Trey, man. She can line up anything that needs to be lined up. She's the go to.
Okay.
And shit, let's
go. Oh, that'll
out,
be
man.
Awesome. Gonna, hey, let's make that happen, man. Word up, man. Like, this Valentine's Day, man. You know what I'm saying? This coming Valentine's Day, man. Teach these motherfuckers how to get some pussy out here.
Right.
Trying to get short though.
And before I go, I want to shout out because when I hear you say the word up, you remind me of, like, I lived in New York for a while when I was on Def Jam. I stayed right through the Holland Tunnel in Jersey. And I just want to shout out a bunch of real niggas that was on that label that I fuck with. I fuck with Reggie Noble, Heavy, Method Man, DMX, Heavy.
Man.
Now, DMX, I don't give a fuck. I don't give a fuck what X is going through. That's a real nigga right here. I don't fuck with that nigga on many levels.
But the thing is, he
you
always
been
like that. DMX always been like that. It's just a different style with the internet
is
around.
Yeah, he's a real nigga, man. I done seen that boy. He ain't never flip-flop, let this label shit. I done seen the labels trying to tell him, come on, we got to get inside. We got to get on inside. And I be standing outside a venue. I might be talking to one of my homies. He's like, hold on. Let me go holler at my man. He going to stop. Come holler at me. I mean, good dude. You know, I met a lot of solid cats from New York. You know what I mean? So I ain't one of them West Coast niggas who got no problems with New York. When I was living in New York, all them niggas told me, they was like, Rich, you seem like an East Coast nigga. Like, you, the way you move, you could fit in out here. Like, so I don't have no problem. I don't bicker with niggas from where they from. You know what I mean? I just fuck with good niggas on the whole. I know niggas from the country, from the A, from the East Coast, West Coast, whatever. So I'm just one of them type of dudes. You know what I mean?
That's what's up, brother.
We appreciate
thank
you, Rich.
Time
thank
you.
Yeah, we definitely
and
appreciate
spending so much time with it.
Yeah, I come out there. Where y'all at? Where y'all located?
I'm in Virginia.
I'm in North Carolina. We all form like Voltron. I know you know about Voltron because I know you old school.
Yeah, hell yeah.
Remember
that.
How
that
Voltron
was
how about? You know what I'm saying? When the motherfuckers all came together, like you got North Carolina, you got Texas, you got Virginia, and you got the Bronx, New York.
Okay, well, yeah, we got the best of the best, and now you got the kid from the West in here. You feel me?
Hey.
You got the best of the best featuring the kid from the West. You know what I'm talking about? So, yeah, it's
all
good, man. I love y'all.
And we all form like vultures.
Thank you.
Much love back, Rich.
Okay,
Thank you so much.
Hey, put this out there, too, for your listeners. If you want to check up on the boy and see what he's doing, my Instagram is the real Richie Rich. I spell the T-H-A. And then real and Richie is R-I-C-H-I-E-R-I-C-H. Follow me on that gram at the real Richie Rich. Or you can get on my Facebook at official Richie Rich. Come tap in, see what I'm doing, see how I'm moving. Check out that Tupac bike I put together, that Harley Davidson with the 30-inch wheel on the front. Machiavelli, man, I keep representing my guy. You know, you can see what I'm doing on my off days and my on days. You know what I'm talking about? A day in the life. So yeah, man, let your listeners know, man. Follow me on the gram, man. Help me get my weight up, man. I'm trying to get back around.
Oh yeah, definitely. They heard you. They heard you. You know what I'm saying?
From the Bay Area. Yeah. Shout out my niggas from the Bay Area too, Mr. Fab, Keith the Sneak, Filthy Rich, Young Mozzie, Drew Down, E40, Short Dog. You know what I mean? All the cats that I fool with, man. We still out here rocking, man. We united, you know. Keith is getting well, and we're going to put this West Coast thing back on the map.
Word.
Snoop Dogg,
definitely shout, definitely
you know
shout out to Keith
shout
the Sneak.
Shout out Young Kendrick Lamar and all the cats that's moving from L.A. too, you know. Like I said, I rock with everybody, the game, you know, a whole bunch of niggas, man. This niggas making some good music out here, you know what I mean? So we're going to line it up, man, and yeah, we're going to line it up. And when I get some more free time, man, we're going to fuck up that part too, you dig?
There we
definitely,
go.
Definitely.
Shout out to all the ladies.
Just like that.
Y'all got ladies that listen to your station? Y'all got ladies that listen to the
of
station?
Of course.
Oh, shout out all the ladies.
Show.
She's a,
yeah, I shout out
one
all
of our, one of our
yeah,
co-hosts is a lady.
Yeah,
Chinchillas, that's a lady.
Co-host. Yeah, yeah. Well, Chilla know what it do. I'm just saying, like,
yeah,
to the
yeah,
ladies
we had
that might be listening, you know. Yeah, to the ladies that might be listening, you know. The kid is real valid in that arena. You know, I like the ladies, man. I got a lady in here in my house right now listening to me tell y'all that I like the ladies, so that should let you know that I like the ladies. Yeah.
Ladies are
yeah,
pretty
so,
awesome.
Hey,
I agree with you.
Yeah, for real. Yeah, so we're going to keep it 100, man. Once again, man, it's Richie Rich, man. East Oakland Town Business. I love y'all. I'm headed to the airport. Y'all hold it down. Keep falling like Voltron. And let's line up that part two.
Right.
Have
a
safe
flight,
brother.
Have a safe flight.
100. All right, I'm gone.
All right. Peace. One. Thank you.
Hey. Y'all niggas have
you
me laughing.
If you have it, if you just tuning in, you just probably missed one of the best interviews we've ever done on this show since we started in 2014. This brother was giving us the game down pat.
Yeah.
And some real shit. Real feelings. Didn't give a fuck who said what. No holds barred. So, hey, shout out to that nigga for being real than a motherfucker, not giving a fuck who listening.
That's why we off the cuff, goddammit.
That's so much wisdom, so much game, so much real talk. Y'all got a good hour of knowledge right there.
This is a symposium of the streets, bringing the heat. I mean, who else could break down the pecking order of how the weight and the product distribution is distributed on from the Indians to the Chiefs?
Snitching on niggas. He gave a pecking order and left it alone. Didn't name no names. Didn't give out no good game. He did it right. That's how you're supposed to do it. You ain't got to snitch to talk about some good shit. Just keep it general, you know.
And
yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah. Now, before we go on to our segment, the BAN segment, we're going to take a little musical break. I got to go ahead and take our little mascot outside for a minute. I had to put on his little blue bandana.
We got to figure out, what's the mascot name, though, man? You never said the mascot's name.
It's S-Dog.
S-Dog?
Yeah, that's what we call him. That's his nickname. S-Dog.
S-Dog.
That nigga get
so my real name.
His real name is Studley, but we call him S Dog around when he put the blue rag on because his favorite album is Dog Food. every time that joint Respect come on and New York come on, he wakes up.
Wow.
Oh shit.
So he's tuned into the streets.
Definitely.
He's definitely tuned into the street. So what we're going to do is we're going to take a little commercial break, music break. We're going to play a joint that Richie Rich did for Pac. He was one of the few cats that actually did tributes for Tupac during around the time period that he passed shortly. Aside from him, it was Tretch, it was Master P. They was the only three at that time. But this joint here is called Do G's Get to Go to Heaven? And hit him with the call-up number.
1-619-924-0703 off the cuff with the guillotine. We here. And this is from what Eric, like Eric said, Do G's Get to Go to Heaven? This was from his 1996 release on Def Jam Records, Seasoned Veteran.
Knowledge.
There we go.
Dedicate this to my man, Tupac. Rest in peace, boy. You know it's all love.
Courage to pray, believe I know better, but somehow I feel I'm lost at the crossroad, but then I'm scared to move across. Could it be what I'm drinking that got me thinking like I'm thinking, Lord, I need help, but I can't help myself. Awaken to the sound of sirens, niggas dying, kids in the street with no food to eat, prostitutes getting money in their only profession, but Lord, I've only got one question. Do G's get to go to heaven? Cause I don't wanna die. But if so, I'd like to know, do G's get to go to heaven? Cause I don't wanna die. Do G's get to go to heaven? Cause I don't wanna die. But if so, I'd like to know, do G's get to go to heaven? Cause I don't wanna die. And if I took a life, or perhaps sold some dope, would you discriminate upon my entry to the gate? I need to know my fate, cause now my life ain't straight. But just look at this place where I live, is oh so crazy. I didn't shoot that man, but I watched him die and saw the pain and the struggle in his eye and didn't cry. So when I start to hear the thunder, are you taking me under? Or is my sin just as bad as the gunner? Do G's get to go to heaven? Cause I don't wanna die. But if so, I'd like to know, do G's get to go to heaven? Cause I don't wanna die. Do G's get to go to heaven? Cause I don't wanna die. But if so, I'd like to know, do G's get to go to heaven? Cause I don't wanna die. For every time I walk by, and every time I got high, for every man that I watch die, Lord, I need to know, do G's get to go for all the women that I ran through? Those that I did and didn't plan to, for every scam I ran my hands through, Lord, I need to know, do G's get to go? And if they get to go, when it's time to meet my maker, will he understand that I am only a man, flesh and bone, born to live and die in a zone? And it gets lonely sometimes, trying to make it on your own. When my baby cries, my intentions are to feed and fulfill the needs of my one and only seed. And if I rob and steal, let it read in my will, pay back the ones who fell victim to my guns on the run. But knowing that I can't hide, why do I feel the way I feel inside? It's like my soul is leaving me. Are you deceiving me? I hear voices saying, believe in me, is it you? I hear that there's a man named God who can fix it when it's twisted. Not saying that I'm all that bad, but I could use a little help, cause at times I can't help myself. Do G's get to go to heaven? Cause I don't wanna die. But if so, I'd like to know, do G's get to go to heaven? Cause I don't wanna die. Do G's get to go to heaven? Cause I don't wanna die. But if so, I'd like to know, do G's get to go to heaven? Cause I don't wanna die. G's get to go. No man shall enter the gate. Do G's get to go? But by the Son, do G's get to go? You can believe that. Do G's get to go? Do G's get to go to heaven? Do G's get to go? If so, I'd like to know, do G's get to go? Cause I don't wanna die. I don't wanna die, but if so, I'd like to know, do G's get to go to heaven?
up. I'm finna tell how niggas speaking on me. But when I come direct, I'm incorrect, you know you phony. They wanna play dumb cause they thinking I wouldn't know it. But when it comes to the actions, you better know I show it. They wanna speak, then let them speak because it's free promotion. Supposed to get paid off what you say, I see no money showing. When it comes to the competition, see no opponent. All I see is motherfucking Satan, people turning on me. Was around when I was down, these clowns acting like they know me. If you tell, don't explain yourself, fuck your testimony. I seen it all, plus I see homies cross like a pedestrian, ain't no path for you to even walk. Yeah, I'm talking in these size 10. You ain't been through what I've been through, so fuck your politics. Have you niggas undercover fags, steady riding dick. Lil' boy ain't drag, what you want some to, I'm bullshit. Steady, you're my player, why you haters mad, I'm proving it. Swagger jacket, get the jack and swag, you ain't fooling shit. You can feel like us, but don't sound like us, take a flight of dip. If you think you do, then you assume, jump up off a cliff.
Never wonder why they hated on me. Hated I never gave a fuck, I guess they never was my homie. Was my homie. Gotta watch, they probably plotting on me. Plotting on me. Watch it get counted, it's a problem. Problem. Oh, they praying on my downfall. I ain't got nothing to prove, but it's fun to prove them wrong. Oh, they praying on my downfall. I ain't got nothing to prove, but it's fun to prove them.
You underestimate, I'ma show who you fucking with. I'm LA, California, I changed that shit to my government. Bet I got them stuck cause the words coming out my lips. Daddy told me shut the fuck up cause it can give me guilt. Gotta have control cause if you don't, then your life in. That shit that I was taught from the cloth that you ain't cutting it. Trying to get a cut up of my bucks, you better think again. Your bass behind my back when I say I ain't giving in. Fuck California dreaming cause every day I be living it. He's out of town, need to sit down and stop pretending quick. I'm watching for imposters that's plotting, I can't look like a lick. But haters throwing shots like a free throw, but like shots they miss. Damn, it's like my name, brung up all the time. All I hear is fame, you gon' live for a long time. Damn, it's like my name, brung up all the time. All I hear is fame, you gon' live for a long time.
Never wonder why they hated on me. Hated I never on gave a fuck. I guess they never was my homie.
Was my homie.
Gotta watch, they probably plotting on me. Plotting on me. Watch it get counted. It's a problem. Oh, they praying on my downfall. I ain't got nothing to prove, but it's fun to prove wrong. Oh, they praying on my downfall. I ain't got nothing to prove, but it's fun to prove wrong.
You can't deny, cause the south side keep a blunt on fire, gotta kick in high.
Can't nobody show more love in the south side.
Gathering up in the summer, creeping the Hummer to the waters. These southern vibes are like no other place in the universe. With the coins and the player saints in the dives of bunnies, so we can roll and ride the whole Southside crew. Now watch how we shine in the midst of the air. We gon' slide to the top, never stop until we hit that platinum drop as quick as snap crackle. I shop the bins a lot as I hit a score. We've been ignored too long and now they want more. You can't deny the love from the Southside. In every spot we ride, we got to show our pride. Block quarters and smoke out the hangouts at empty parking lots, finding you the perfect door to take you out. The ball of city of fame, now what you claim? It's a Southside thing, and can't nobody show more love.
Can't nobody show more love than the Southside crew.
Gangsters and thugs, everything's gravy. Coming down in mama cities as I cross Green Falls to impress the ladies. Hey baby, you wanna take a ride with the crew across Texas in the legend jam and slow down screw? For years the dirty drive has been totally ignored. Dead in and out the line, about to smash billboard records being sold in the 50 states. 19 10 on state, on time to play. We wait with open arms, ready to parlay. It's the AJWK in the thick of the shed. Don't take it the wrong way, we ain't capping no bragging. Raising sweet and catch a seat on the southern bandwagon. Come on, come on, where all the shots are called. From wall to wall, let's bottle with ball. We show love.
Ain't nobody show more love than a Southside Bubbles recline, celebrating the line. What a candy shine. Ace time to plot the makers and winners and clap the five figures. I'm dropping a hit with the dead end nigga. You can't touch this. I reminisce on how we taught us. I will never pull out like this on this rap shit. But now here we go. Some stars to show. Goals reaching the highest peak. It grew for my soul. Now it's easy to know that this classy ass thing. Put heat in the waist. Can cause a major case by giving a lyrical embrace. No comparable to none. John Perry on the fun of the song. That's how we chilling, having fun. Gas station filled up. The crew when they showing their forms, but that's how we do all night until the early morning. Only we can be the Lord to last all through, cause can't nobody show more love than the Southside crew out the line. Ain't nobody show more love than the Southside crew.
Temporary much, you don't wanna be my enemy, wanna be a friend of me, rather be my ally, don't wanna go to war with me, nah, roll with me, nah, don't get me upset, I pump that shotty to his heavy, plus you don't wanna get me, to the point where we can't speak is when I let the burner represent me, something deadly, nah, it's Betty Bye-Bye, relax, refresh your mind. Outstanding, outspoken, from the first bar of my song, could tell I'm not joking. This high class, top shelf shit, preserved for freshness, quality hits. You see what I'm saying, can almost smell it. Nah, that's that kush, that OG, melted to the volcano ash.
But when we blow out the smoke, it look like the fog. Now moving on from now, I got a pocket full of scratch. Cause I work hard, it take years to lock yourself in, it's hard. Now I'm written in stone, and I ain't talking about the grave. This is live from L.A., my next stop is the cage for a little bit. I gotta serve this time, cause in front the grand jury, some crooked cops live. When I get back, I ain't even got no words. I'ma show you how I get down, show you how I work. But you don't wanna be my enemy, wanna be a friend of me. Rather be my ally, don't wanna go to war with me. Nah, roll with me. Nah, don't get me upset. I pump that shotty to his empty. Plus, you don't wanna get me. To the point where we can't speak is when I let the burner represent me. Something deadly. Nah, it's Betty, bye bye. Relax and rest your mind.
Hey, can I please take this time to say something since we heard some Southside love? Y'all know them damn Astros won the World Series champions in 2017.
Yeah.
You can deserve that.
Heard, man.
Congratulations.
And I shout out to Paul Wall and Johnny Dang because, you know, they're hooking them niggas up with grills and everything. Houston is going crazy right now. Appreciate that, Sandman. Look here. I just love the Astros. Hey, at the end of the day, I love my city. And they, every time they got interviewed, they said, we did it for the city. Even the owner said they did it for the city. Everybody was all about their city life. We went through some devastating shit, and they brought back some hope and some security. You know what I'm saying? Then your boy, I'm going to fuck up his name. Correa, however you say that man name, him and Daniela, then got engaged. All of that shit was a beautiful thing, man. I'm just saying.
I gotta say is this: if the fucking Houston A's could win a damn pennant, come on, Knicks. Like, come on, B. All these bum ass teams are stepping up. I'm still waiting for my Knicks to step up, man. Like,
you gotta do this to
they just
general,
need to
man,
fire everybody.
Well, the problem with the Knicks is that, you know, it's been over the past 15 years, it's just been a lack of consistency. Even when y'all made the playoff runs, you know, in terms of getting to the playoffs, when you look at what happened with Marbury when he got there in 2004, you know, him and Lenny Wilkins, you know, had their issues. And, of course, him and Isaiah. Then they had Larry Brown, who was a great coach, but he's way too –
They didn't even
too...
give Larry Brown a chance.
Larry
Brown was only
coach.
There for like 1 year.
But you got to look at Larry's history. Larry has a history of moving around constantly, and his playing style in terms of how he coaches, he's a very defensive-oriented coach who does not – like to play rookies, number one, and he doesn't like to really get wide open on the ball. I'm still bugged out about the 2004 Olympics. We should have won the gold with that team we had, but Larry didn't want to turn them boys loose. You know?
Larry's too much of a conservative coach.
He is. I love Larry, but Larry will coach you in terms of the knowledge. He'll give you everything you need to know to play the right way, as he says. But Larry is stubborn on how he likes to do it, and Larry doesn't know how to adjust when he has to.
That's a sad fact.
And
but you know what time it is.
We know what it is.
You know what time it is. Somebody's about to go on the fucking chopping block. It's chopping block time. About to sharpen up that guillotine. And,
yes,
you know, first and foremost, you know, I love to eat. and pizza is one of my favorite foods. This guy, Papa Johns. This John. Dude, Papa John, gotta get the guillotine. I already know, y'all know what's going on when this dude, Papa Johns, basically said the reason why his sales is declining is because of the whole, you know, football players taking the knee. You know, that whole fiasco, basically. He's sitting there saying, this, ever since that happened, his pizza sales has been going down.
But please understand, he didn't said some shit, though. This nigga, been Papa John, been tripping for years. I stopped fucking with that nigga about 3 years ago. They pizza good than a bitch, but nigga, I'll be damned if you gonna sit there and talk shit about black folks and still get my money, though. That's hard to swallow. This nigga been talking shit.
Yeah,
you know,
like, that's really be real. This pizza is fucking atrocious. I remember one time, me and my lady, whatever, it was one night, you know, we wanted to eat something new. And we overheard the whole Papa John's cheeseburger pizza shit. So we're like, fuck it, let's try that shit out.
Yeah.
I don't know why. I don't even know why we did it to ourselves. That shit was more pickles than burger. Like, imagine that shit. Pickles on pizza. Sliced pickles on pizza. That's all you're really tasting. You know, and ever since then, I never got Papa John's ever again. You know, like, Papa John's from before then, it just always been nasty to me because it's more crust than cheese and tomato sauce.
And we have to also give our listeners, you know, John Schnatter is his real name. But we also have to talk about some of the things that he has done that have been atrocious on his business as well. Because when President Obama passed through the Affordable Health Care Act, you know, he decided he was going to cut his employees' hours so he wouldn't have to pay that insurance. Also, too, in addition to being a Trump supporter,
expose that dude, Papa John's. Expose him.
And he also was going to raise the prices on his pizza to appease his shareholders. You know, and that's just a couple of the offenses. But what we're talking about right now, ladies and gentlemen, you know, before we're talking about
you added that.
I think the Koch brothers are part of his shareholder, a major part of his shareholding. If I'm not mistaken. Yeah,
but,
that's, you know, that's straight racism at its best, at its worst, though, but at its best.
But what we're talking about, ladies and gentlemen, is, for number one, you know, one thing about Kaepernick, no matter what you feel about it, and me and, you know, King have had discussions in private about it, but one thing I can say I respect about Kaepernick is that he actually led a movement that was bringing attention to what is we've been is black people and people of color and our white brothers and sisters who have been fighting with us as well about the injustices. So now you have a guy who's going to blame the NFL players because of their deciding to take participation and bringing attention to something that his black line, bottom line is now in the red, flatlining because of simply doing the right thing, letting people know about what's going on in society.
And at the end of the day, it's not like this dude Colin Kaepernick is telling everybody to go on a hunger strike. At the end of the day, you can kneel all you want. If this motherfucking pizza is mad good, I'm getting me a motherfucking pizza. I don't care if you're kneeling. I'm going to go get me a pizza. At the end of the day, your pizza fucking sucks. It's nasty. And you keep on talking about this fresh ingredient bullshit. First of all, if the ingredients were so fresh, the pizza wouldn't taste like sugar. That's number one. Like, if you taste that shit, like, why the dough was so sugary a little bit? It's like why does shit taste sweet? I don't want no sweet pizza.
On the cool, hey. I like that pizza. I can't even say nothing, but I'm willing to go without it because at the end of the day, I'm not finna fund a racist organization that's doing everything to out of spite to fuck off they workers and to do backhanded type shit. At the end of the day, that man that's running the company and a lot of his shareholders are wrong. And what both of y'all just said, it's not like Kaepernick isn't raising legitimate concerns and opening people's eyes to a legitimate problem. And the problem is him and his shareholders are the problem.
Like, they are the ones who believe
his pizza
that
is the problem.
The
pizza is nasty.
Look,
a fucking
a hungry
dog wouldn't eat that fucking pizza. That's why he says, at the end of the day, that's what it is. Because he could be part of the fucking clan. If his pizza was fucking good, niggas would still buy that shit. They wouldn't give a fuck. They'd be like, man, look, hey, the pizza's still good. I don't care if he got a sweatshop in his backyard. If that pizza is good, that pizza is good. At the end of the day, the pizza's nasty. And that's the main reason why he's getting the guillotine, because you're going to sit there and blame somebody else for your poor ingredients. And you're going to sit there and try to blame Colin Kaepernick just for a fucking cop-out. You sound like you have no knowledge to any type of game whatsoever. And
blame,
at the end of the day, you know, at the end of the day, you know what it is. A starving man or a drunken man always tell the truth.
Well, they said that he lost $70 million. So guess what, John Schnatter? You can lose $100 million. How's that? And we'll eat Chanelo. Chanelo's, and
all he's doing is fucking himself right now. All he's doing is digging himself a deeper ditch to fall in, because his outlandish rants are not helping his product any, and it's not changing what people have been accustomed to finding out about him. He's been exposed over the past 2 years, and all he's doing is making the exposure legitimate. Nobody now questions if it's just a rumor that his company comes from racist roots. We know now. He just gave us all the facts out of the audience's mouth. So now, you dumb fuck, you were losing $70 million, you're about to go fucking bankrupt because of your stupid ass and running your dumb ass mouth. Your fault. Even if you thought you were Colin Kaepernick before, fool, it's your stupid ass. Keep your mouth shut, take the money, and keep it moving. It's a business. Now you turn the business personal, you dumb fuck. You signing your own death certificate, fool.
There you go.
Now, who's number two on the chopping block?
Tyrese.
What more do you want from me?
Play that clip for him. We got to hit that clip for him.
This is all I got. This is all I got. Don't take my baby, okay? I've been away from my baby for 2 months. I just want my baby. And no one's listening because no one's in the courtroom. I'm not doing anything illegal. But I don't want nobody. Oh, my God. Am I doing something illegal by doing this video? Or is this? Am I protected by the First Right Amendment or the amendment? Don't take my baby. I'm at $13,000 a month. What more do you want from me?
Okay, can I say something
Bitch, shut the fuck up.
Had to hit him with that. Oh,
Lord.
Go ahead, Chilla.
We laugh too hard, that shit is funny, but it's not funny what he's talking about. We always talk about how the artists and public figures do not need to go on social media and break down or get into their personal issues or show too much emotion. So that is the most problem, the biggest problem with that is not the fact that he's losing his kid. I think it's over, like he spanked his kid too hard or something. I don't want to get me personally. Now, whatever everybody else on the, as far as the host and the co-host say, that's on them. But I'm going to tell you straight up, for me, it's not that I'm laughing at what he's going through. I am laughing at the way he chose to deal with it. My nigga, that's the wrong way to do it. You just made yourself sound real fucking crazy and opened yourself up to ridicule.
Well,
that was crazy.
I would say this, and then I'm going to let y'all rock. This is all I got to say, because everybody know me as being a heartless motherfucker. You know, that's why they call me Sam. That's one of the reasons why they call me Sam, man. I'm all this. But, you know what I mean? I feel where you're coming from. You know, he loves his daughter, whatever the case may be. Understandable. But here's a couple of things that go with that. Number one, you wouldn't be in this predicament if he wasn't such a fucking dickhead. You know, let's really be real. Let's really be real. We're not going to sit there and act like Tyrese is a fucking saint. He's done a lot of dumb shit. He said a lot of dumb shit. And then now he want to sit here and, you know, beg for forgiveness of what may have you. You can say that's him begging for forgiveness. And then furthermore, what I've heard or what I've read, people did try to reach out to him after that. People did try to reach out to him and see if he was good, and he still shitted on people. So what's
like,
my dude?
He wanted to shut his phone off, but he refused.
Yeah, it's like,
and
my dude, like, you bipolar, my dude. Something, I really think he needs to go talk to some professional help because he's very bipolar. He doesn't know if he's coming or going. And this whole shit started from the whole, I think at the end of the day, he just wishes he could be the Rock. I really think that. Because really, this whole thing stems from him beefing with The Rock. From before, he never was. Like, the whole situation where, you know, his daughter and all that, it wasn't just really that much of an issue until they started beefing with The Rock. Really think of that.
And he just said something about making it his last post. He put up The Rock and your boy Van Diesel, and he said something, and he was like, this is the last post I'm going to make. Nigga, if you have to say it's the last post you're going to make about this, don't make it. Because apparently he spoke to somebody, and they consulted with him, and they gave him some good advice, but this was going to be the last post. Nigga, you should have listened to whoever was advising you. And then he had the nerve to sit there and cry about his friends not helping him.
Going back to what I said, one more thing, I'm going to let y'all go. One more thing, King, then you can carry on after me. Like what I said from before, either a drunken mind or a starving man will always tell the truth. Now, carry on.
That's a fact, right? But you know what it all boils down to? It boils down to the fact that this dude's pockets is hurting right now. That's what it's all about.
A part of it could be
about his daughter, but it's the main reason why he's going at The Rock so hard, because The Rock is now getting a spinoff as the Tom's character with Jason Statham. And he's feeling a little salty about that. So
I didn't know that.
He's looking at it as The Rock.
Franchise.
Yeah, he's looking at The Rock cutting in on his bag.
That's how this whole debacle started. That's how this whole thing started with him and The Rock, because basically he's sitting there saying, like, basically him and The Rock, I guess, met up or whatever, and him and The Rock had a private conversation basically saying, like, oh, don't, basically Tyrese is telling The Rock, don't be in the spinoff of the Fast and Furious. And then The Rock said, okay, no doubt, I'm not going to be in a spinoff. Like, nah, I'm not going to. And then basically the producers or whatever of Fast and the Furious met up with The Rock, and they pitched him the same idea, and The Rock took the movie role. Now, if that's true, that is a little flaky, I'm not going to lie. But at the same token, The Rock don't owe you a goddamn thing.
Look at how he handled the TGT situation, where he acted like he deserved a bigger piece of the pie because he was in more movies.
Thank you.
And he was throwing Genuine and Tank under the bus.
Thank you. He should have sat there and shit on them. And then now you want to sit here and be crying out like, oh, no, nigga, you reap what you fucking sow. It's difficult for me to feel sorry for motherfuckers that did bullshit in the past, and then when the bullshit comes on them, now everybody was like, oh, the poor baby. No, nigga. Feel it.
Plus,
feel that burn.
On Instagram, because I follow him there, too. He always be showing off his cars, showing off his bottles, showing off his coat.
Feel that burn, because you was doing the same thing to other motherfuckers. Feel that burn.
You know?
All those pretty black women that you shitted on, all those pretty black women that worshipped you, that watched Baby Boy constantly, Baby Boy DVD. You shared on all of them. Now you're going to feel the burn.
How does that even sound, him asking another nigga to cut their money off because he's feeling some type of way? That's a competitive industry.
That's what Tyrese said. Tyrese basically said, yeah, Yeah, exactly. That's what he said in the particular Instagram, and I think he spoke about it too in one of his videos. He said that Rod basically turned his back on the Fast and the Furious family. Like, my man, what you mean Fast and Furious family? My man, we all here doing a job. At the end of the day, we're here to feed our families. Like, I don't give a fuck about y'all. All y'all niggas grown ass men. You know what I'm saying?
He wants to rock like,
and then he wanna sit there and be like, cause he took this tweet down too. He tweeted this. He sit there and say, "Oh, the Rock. Basically, the Rock taking that role is disrespecting this dude on Paul Walker."
I had to cut in on this one, and not to mention the fact that even throughout that whole little tirade, he was threatening The Rock's daughter in the end. And then said he was on steroids. Yeah.
He said, "Oh, if you don't give a fuck about my daughter, well, I don't give a fuck about your daughters." How you say that? And you say you're such a great father. Even if a man wished ill will on your daughter, you supposed to still take the higher road. If you claim you're a good father.
Didn't you just play a pastor and star? Nigga, you better take heed to your role, goddamn. Karma's a bitch. That's why I ain't that shit.
Better drop Sweet Lady one, too.
Well, there's a lot going on with that situation. There's a lot going on with that situation because there's also allegedly, now he was cleared of this, I believe, today, but there was an investigation about, you know, child abuse that supposedly that he had, like, you know, beat his daughter, but the thing is, when we get back to the genesis of this whole situation, this is about the jelly that's the worst kind, and it gets you jammed up on that green-eyed monster when you fondle in somebody's pockets on their finances trying to count their funds. We don't do that over here. And for him, and apparently he's forgot this, The Rock is at $20 million a picture. So this is called capitalism. This is called making money. And my thing is, if they feel like they can drop another franchise, a separate franchise with him, then he has every right to go ahead and capitalize that.
And the thing about it, it's not just because he's the Rock, because that would be some bullshit. So I ain't gonna lie, in a way, I'll be like, that's some bullshit too. But this dude, Rock, actually, his character in Fast and Furious is interesting. I know who Hobbs is. And I'm not even I'm not a Fast and the Furious motherfucker. I don't watch that shit. But I know who Hobbs is.
He saved that franchise.
I don't know who the fuck Tyrese is. What is his name in the movie? My wife told me his name and I forgot his name. Something about piano or something like that. I don't even know that dude's name.
Jody.
Yeah, that's all I know is Jody. Like, my man, you're gonna sit there and say, "Oh, if The Rock is in the new Fast and the Furious, then I'm not gonna be in the Fast and the Furious." You know why?
Nigga, you better take
because
that bag.
You're gonna sit there and say you broke, but you're gonna sit there and gonna just ditch. You're just gonna ditch your so-called Fast and the Furious fam because The Rock is. He sounds just like Jody, like a big ass fucking baby. Whatever doesn't go his way. He want to bitch and moan. Where's Ving Rhames at? Tell Ving Rhames get the fucking belt for this nigga.
Somebody made a meme about that, too.
The situation with him and his daughter, it is fucked up. You know, I'm not a father, but I'm taking care of, you know, I help take care of my, nieces, nephews, what may have you. I know how it is for them not to be around for a long period of time. I can only imagine how it is with your own offspring. But my dude, it's the reason why you're going through this. You can't sit here and say you're completely innocent. And I'm not going to sit here and say the wife, his wife, his ex-wife is innocent. You know? But at the end of the day, you jumping on social media and doing that shit, you put a fucking target on that fucking eggplant head of yours.
Plus, not to mention,
you're gonna have to hold these shots.
he became a meme. He became a the new challenge right now. You know, I had to jump on it before I went on the air.
I'm telling you. So all that shit, I don't care what nobody. I don't care what nobody's all that shit. Don't beat me. Don't beat me. No, fuck that. You reap what you sow. At the end of the day, you did your dirt. Now you're gonna have to receive the same thing. That's all common logic. You know, it is what it is. You know what I mean? At the end of the day, I hope you do. I hope he does get shit situated that he can see his daughter again, and they can get back to a normal relationship. And if that's true, stop fucking pounding your daughter into the dirt. And then not only that, stop fucking singing "Let's Get It On" to your daughter. How about that, you fucking weirdo?
Yeah, that was, you know, it's funny because, you know, in situations like that, you know, people, when they go through drama, they're trying to elicit some type of social sympathy through social media about their plight. But there are certain problems that I think are better, and I think we all agree on this, that need to be addressed privately and need to be discussed in the confines of whatever judicial process is appropriated for that matter. You know, this is the problem. Everyone thinks that every news, everything that's a headline in your personal life shouldn't be put out for the tabloids to read.
For real. That's a real thought. And then they wonder why shit like this happened when people are talking about it and they're like, why don't y'all just leave me alone? Nigga, you put your business out there, and in the manner that you did it, shit, man, people are people. You are an entertainer. You are now entertaining the world, but not
you're
in the way
celebrity.
That you wanted. Exactly. And at the end of the day, shit, keep your shit behind closed doors, and nobody has anything on you but what you do in the movie,
which
is your character.
According to him, you forgot, Chinchilla. According to him, he's not an entertainer, and he's not a singer or a producer. He's none of those. He's just a father. So we gotta wipe out Baby Boy. We gotta wipe out Sweet Lady. We gotta wipe out all of that from our memory. He never sung before. He never did the Coca-Cola commercial before. We
just
gotta wipe that all out.
You still a Coke dude? You still a dude that sold the Coca-Cola?
He is not a singer. He's not a singer. He got WWE amnesia.
You know what?
Yeah.
But good you brought that up. You know what that is?
He was playing kayfabe.
Look, all that shows is he is now out of touch with reality. He is not only on the brink of losing it and a nervous breakdown, he has lost it, and he is trembling into a downward spiral in a deep nervous breakdown because, nigga, you are no longer living in reality. You may not be the characters you play, but you are an actor. You are a singer because that is how you make your living. That is what you are known for. Yes, you may be a father first. Yes, you may be a black man first. Yes, you may be a son first. All of that. But at the end of the day, the world that you are crying to knows you as the damn boy in the Coca-Cola commercial with the headphones on the bus, the nigga in Baby Boy that was getting his ass whooped by
Oh, my Coca-Cola, yeah. He had a fucking lip ring. Get your butt ass out of here.
It was a long time coming to get this dude to guillotine for real. He had it coming for a minute. We just had to give him the icing on the cake.
But look, one more thing to say about him before y'all actually drop the guillotine on him. I should have known something was wrong in his world when he took that part in Star. I love Star. I watch Star all the time. But that particular part for Tyrese to play a preacher that ends up, like, going off and I don't – they could have had somebody else because that right there tainted my whole picture of Tyrese because he tries to make himself be, like, this friend that helps everybody. Last thing I saw, I think he was sitting down talking to Brandy. He always sitting down talking to girls and his partners and trying to help them out and be the sensitive shoulder to lean on, giving the good advice. And this nigga came out in that part, and it was, like, totally different than any part I've ever seen him in. But, yeah, I think Sandman's right. He just turned into the baby boy Jody that everybody knows and doesn't love on the cold. He's, like, looking like a bitch all the way around right now.
at the end of the
like
day,
though,
at the end of the as a black man, I hope he does get through the trials and tribulations. It's just, you
of
know,
course.
We all judge people. We do this shit on this show every Friday. I'm not gonna lie, we crack jokes and all that shit.
Yeah.
It happens, but you can't sit here when the joke is on you. It don't matter the depth of the joke. Because
yeah.
when it came to his jokes, or when it came to his judging, he had no depth. So when it gets served upon you, you got to take those shots, homie. Especially the position you in. And that's what a lot of these celebrities done forgot. A lot of these motherfuckers just can't be coded. You know what I'm saying? They can't take that shit, but they could dish shit. Fuck that shit. Take that shit on the chin, motherfucker. Like your lip ring.
Definitely.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, at the end of the day, hey, yeah, fuck that dude. What's his name again? John Shalabi? What the fuck his name is again?
John Shalabi.
John Shalabi? What the fuck is whatever the fuck his name is. Fuck you and your nasty ass pizza. As a matter of fact, maybe, you know, we should order the dude Tyrese some Papa Johns. Maybe he might feel a little better. You know
and a Coca-Cola.
Yeah, some pickle pizza
and
Coca-Cola.
Pizza. More than fuck your
maybe
pizza.
Maybe he might feel a little better.
Coca-Cola, fuck your racist ass team, so I can blame. That's the most important thing from the Papa Johns game.
That's how we ended on that note. And the king, and it's about time for the king to head out of here. It's been a real solid show. Big salute to Richie Rich for stopping by and chopping up with us, giving us one of the best interviews we ever had. We're definitely going to welcome him on the part two segment.
You know what I'm saying?
In terms of pizza, we are endorsing Chanelo's, Pizza Hut, and Domino's. We are off the cuff radio now
so
officially.
Far, yeah, they safe right now. They safe. They safe
we are
right now.
Endorsing
they
those
up.
Brands.
No, man. Cut the check, Domino's. Cut the check, Domino's. We repping, you know what I'm saying? Like, and make
ain't
sure next time.
Y'all ain't been in the streets since Ninja Turtles, so we'll put y'all back on.
You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? So next time y'all listen to off the cuff radio. In the comfort of your home, you can order up some Domino's and enjoy the show while having a piping hot pepperoni or extra cheese or what may have you pie in the comfort of your own home listening to Off the Cuff Radio. Bam!
With
cut
some
the Domino's.
Gotta get some Sprite or some. That Coke, all you're going to do is make us laugh, at least for the next month. All
right.
There we go. So Domino's cut that check. And I'm about to sign up out of here. And on that note, right. We'll see y'all next Friday night. Same time, same channel. Y'all know what it is.
You know what I'm saying? We got Trey Pizzy at Japan in the building. Once again, we're going to have, you know what I'm saying? BX stand up one more time. Because last time we had Japan, but now we're going to have Trey Pizzy and Japan in the building. We're going to have Broke and Trippy in the fucking building repping the BX. So make sure when y'all call in and listen to that, get y'all Domino's pizza, goddammit. And tell Tyrese, give y'all a motherfucking free Pepsi or Coca-Cola or whatever. Shoot. And on that note, peace out, motherfucker.
Hey. Yep.
We out.
Do you suffer from chronic CFED or can't focus energy drain? Try over-the-counter Vibrin. One tablet contains the same caffeine as a cup of coffee, but without the calories or coffee breath. Vibrin. Caffeine, not coffee. Taking Vibrin may result in increased productivity and decreased dread in setting alarms. Unexpected enjoyment of the graveyard shift has been associated with Vibrin. Vibrin may be a better budget option than drinking coffee. It may also decrease the urge to doze off, skip work, or exhibit signs of slacking. All jokes aside, always read the label, take only as directed, and limit caffeine as it may cause real side effects. Not for children under age 12.
Give joy, get joy right now at Kohl's and take an extra 25% off. With an extra 25% off, Cuddle Duds throw pillows are $11.24 each, or a Keurig K55 is $74.99, and holiday jammies for the family are 50% off, plus an extra 25% off. Santa's on his way to Kohl's this Sunday from 1 to 3 p.m. All the jolly details are at Kohl's.com/Santa. Give joy, get joy at Kohl's. Select styles, 25% offer valid December 7th through 9th with promo code SANTA. Some exclusions apply. See store at Kohl's.com for details.